So we are in the black hole laboratory. What you're looking at, that's an analog rotating black hole. As a first step, we fill up the space in here in the back. We put water in there, and then we also put what's called fluorescent dye. Makes your fingers dirty. It's actually sort of orangey, but then it takes a blue part of the spectrum of the light and converts blue into green. There are about 2,000 liters of water in there. If you follow me, here we have two valves which we can open and control how much is going through each inlet. We have two inlets in our tank. We feed in the water from this side and also from the other side. And so we have this rectangular tank and we fill in the water this way. So by feeding it in this particular way, you give it angular momentum. And then what we have a hole in the center. These are exchangeable center holes. The water is coming in, and because of the way we feed it, it starts spinning and it's draining in the center. So it's a stationary draining fluid flow or just a bathtub vortex flow. So this is not a black hole for me or you. That's a black hole for small excitations in this system. So if you look at sound waves or little ripples on the surface, this is what we are interested, they have a certain propagation speed. And if you set up fluid flows where the background velocity of the flow exceeds the propagation speed of the little ripples, you can set up what's called analogue horizons. So suppose you're in a one-dimensional fluid flow and you look at small excitations, and they can be moving up or downstream of the flow. But if you have a region where the fluid flow exceeds the speed of your little ripples on the free surface, then it means that if you are in this region, you cannot propagate against the flow. So if, let's say you would be in this region where the flow is supercritical, so faster than the perturbations. I am in a region where it's subcritical, and we want to exchange information only using the little ripples on the free surface. Then I can send information to you downstream, but you cannot send any information upstream because the flow is faster going downstream so that nothing can counterpropagate. So in the region where exactly the two speeds, the perturbation speed of the little ripple on the surface and the background flow are equal, that's your analog black hole horizon. So this is a bit of a more difficult system, so it's not one-dimensional. It has a two-dimensional velocity component, meaning it has a radial component, the water is draining, and it has an angular moment, the water is spinning. And what you can see, there are two horizons. And I don't know if I can visualize it, I can try. So you can see, I'm looking for two, there are two horizons in there. There's one when the total velocity of the fluid flow, so radial and angular momentum, exceed the little ripples on the surface. And this is what we call an ergo horizon. So any fluctuation that comes inside this ergo horizon cannot counterpropagate to the fluid flow. It gets dragged along, it's called frame dragging, but it can still escape. There is another point where the radial velocity, only the radial component, is faster than the little ripple on the surface, and that's called the analog event horizon. So if you're in a flow here, you see nothing special has happened, right? Perturbations can go in each direction. If I'm going to a point where the background flow exceeds the perturbation speed, you see a little cone opening in the back, and this cone opens if and only if the background flow exceeds the speed of the perturbation. I don't know if you can see it. Can you see it?
Yeah, I see it now.
So, and now if I manage, and I need to now go up all the way here, and then you see the cone nicely here. You see how this cone tilts more and more and more, and at some point this cone tilts completely inside. And once this cone is not like this, it tilts like this. That's where the effective black hole horizon is. And between these two horizons here, there are some very interesting scattering processes happening. A big part of that is to set up this background flow in the best way for the purposes of mimicking rotating black holes. When I say that, I have something very particular in mind, and that's a very bizarre process that happens around rotating black holes. So a rotating black hole has, at least it has to have a mass and an angular momentum. What can happen because you have these two horizons, you have this ergosphere and you have this black hole horizon, and you have this frame dragging region. So if something comes into this region, a small perturbation, it scatters with this black hole, and it extracts a little bit of angular momentum from the rotating black hole. And so this is what's called super-radiant scattering process. You can come out with more energy, loosely speaking, and this energy comes from the angular momentum of the rotating black hole, or in our case, the analog rotating black hole. What is really interesting is because when you have a real-life setup, and even a very controlled real-life setup, you have to come up with ways to actually detect this effect because they're very small. And also this is perhaps a really old-style fluid flow experiment. People have been experimenting with for 100 years probably. What they haven't gotten back then and what we have now is the technology. So what we're using is top-of-the-art cameras with a very high frame rate per second and a very high spatial resolution. We're hunting for the very small. Not so small like the gravitational waves, but it's still very small, and I can tell you how small. If you look at that flow, and I'm in a regime where this analogy should hold, I'm looking at small excitations on the top, like that. I can stimulate them, for example. These are not very small, but it's better to see it like that. And usually what you want is that this little amplitude of the sky, that it is small compared to the height of the fluid flow. So what we want to send in is a wave with an amplitude of a millimeter. The change is tiny, so the increase in the amplitude is at best a tenth, so 0.1 millimeter. What we really want to see are tiny changes in the amplitude of those waves. What I want to see is when the wave scatters with this vortex, with this analog rotating black hole, that it increases its energy. By interacting with this effective rotating black hole, it gains energy. And that's exactly what should happen around astrophysical rotating black holes. An astrophysical rotating black hole loses its angular momentum. And one way of losing it is through this super radiant scattering process. So whatever comes, it scatters with it, and it can actually transfer some of the angular momentum from the rotating black hole onto, for example, a gravitational wave or other objects. But this is more a test of principle to study this effect, which has not been seen before, in a very controlled way, and it's true, we are sending in, or we are going to improve this much further. That's just the first step. People usually like it because it is very hands-on. One of the huge challenges to overcome was to measure the free surface over a relatively large area. And you can see the area now indicated by this light where the bright green is. So, and what you see above here, what we developed here is an air-water interface sensor. And what it does, it projects in the middle, there is a blue LED light, and it projects a random pattern changing with 500 frames per second onto this free surface. And then you have two cameras on the edges of the sensor. And then what you do, you take also 500 images per second. The first step you need to do, you take a series of images to find out which points corresponds to the same physical point in these two images. And you look at a correlation. And it works exactly in the way, if you wish, if you have your eyes, you take from everything two images, but your brain converts it into one. So this is what we do, and with this information, we can reconstruct the free surface. Here on the screen, you see the reconstructed image through this process. It's a little bit better than our eyes because I get exact amplitudes here. You see, you can see all the waves coming in and you can see how these waves scatter here and how they get deformed. I have to say that we started a year ago. So before that was a storage room. What we have put together in 1 year, I think it's really incredible. We have great support here. So what we are doing right now, we are testing. We're testing how good is the sensor. So this is a nice stage. It's also a little bit of a nerve-wracking stage because we could be very close to see this effect, or we could maybe be a year, maybe two. I don't think, I hope not, but we could be, one doesn't know when we will see it. So it's an exciting time.
Intricate link between the matter and the space-time. Just imagine, trying to imagine these two huge objects, what they're doing to the matter, to the space-time around it, as they, and the space-time must be going, oh my God.